Okay, all right. One, two, three. I'm glad we're all coming. That's why I'm just joking. All right. I get mixed up all the time. Do I have enough verses? Have I read them up? Now, verse number 10. For this cause, what cause is he going back to? For this cause.
Verse 9.
A man was created for the woman. Neither was a man to one, but the woman for the man. So the woman has got to be in subjection to her husband, and that's what Scripture says in Ephesians chapter 5, too, doesn't it? But the 10th verse, power on her head, power because of the angels. What angels do you think they're going back to?
That's verse 10, he said?
Yeah, verse 10. Huh?
Wouldn't it be God's angels?
Could be God's angels. Could be the evil angels.
Oh, really?
Could be evil. Fallen angels. Now, where do we... What is it?
The ones that are chained.
Now, in the book of 2 Peter, working on 2 Peter. Now, I've finished this 1st and 2 Thessalonians. I'm working on the 2 Peter book. And first, the 2 Peter, he talks about this too, something about the two different people. But I go back in that to chapter 6 of Genesis. Remember those angels that are sons of God, so-called? But in Job, it says the sons of God were with God in the creation, so they're angels, angelic beings. Now, a lot of people say that's just the sons of Shem or something else, but I think they're angelic beings, fallen ones. In fact, it says there were giants in the earth, a special, horrible relationship. Somehow these evil angels got themselves bodies, like human bodies, and had marriages with women, and that word for giants in the Hebrew is Nephilim. Not fall means to fall, fallen ones. And because of that, those angelic beings, just think, if they had continued with these giants, where would the Lord Jesus come as far as the incarnation? The whole race would be contaminated. So God destroyed the whole nation except those eight people, Noah and Mrs. Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and their wives. Eight people and two of all the types of animals and insects and birds into that ark. And so I think the angels could be referring to this because of the angels. I know Dr. Amar Dehan years ago in his teaching on these things mentioned that because of the angels. In other words, we don't want any more evil angels to come and cohabit with women, and especially a woman that's out of place. She ought to have power. Maybe it's in respect to her husband in line so that the angels don't go after her. That's one of the possibilities. Do you have some other comments on that question? Yes, Tammy. And then...
Verse 6 of Jude, it says, and the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, being reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day.
Yes, that's very good. That refers, left their first estate, angelic being coming down. So that's also part of this Hebrews, Genesis chapter 6. Randy, John, and then Joanne.
What would the meaning of having power, or as it's find authority, why would it say that?
Okay, I think now, my explanation, the power would be the proper authority, maybe the hair that's proper length, see, it could be, on her head. In other words, properly attired as a woman. Remember, it says earlier that the man, his hair, if it's short, it's a crime, but for the woman, it's good to have long. Verse 15, see, if a woman have long hair, it's her glory. Her hair is given to her for a covering. So maybe she's in line with her husband, could be, as far as the power. I'm not sure, but that's one possibility. Could refer to the power. See, I forget. Let's see, who was it next?
Randy, the other guy.
Oh, yeah, John, I'm sure, the other guy. Okay, the other guy, go ahead.
Some people were saying that there might be, I don't think it happened, might be the return of the Nephilim during the tribulation period.
You know, it's, who knows? All kinds of things are going to happen during the Revelation. Yeah, Bill.
In the time of David, because he killed Goliath, was Goliath a Nephilim?
I don't know. Some people, you read a book.
He was. How did he come about? Because that's long after Noah.
Oh, yeah.
What's a Nephilim?
Fallen ones. Not fall, to fall. Fallen ones. Let's see. But...
Goliath was an
Anakim,
which is a giant.
He was a giant, yeah.
Is he just like a physical giant?
Probably a physical giant. Probably a physical giant rather than the other. Yeah, he was. Yeah, pass it down.
The flood killed the offspring of these.
That's right.
If we're taking it as a standpoint, these Nephilim married or intermarried with the women, human women, then they would have been all destroyed in the flood.
Right. They'd be gone.
And there was part of these angels that were reserved in chains, and a third of them or whatever the number is, and the rest are still tormenting out there in the earth.
That's right, fallen spirits. All right, so these are possibilities. We're not sure. Yes, fine.
Well, are we going to skip verse 8?
Well, we took that last week.
We took that last week.
Yeah, 8, 9. We start with 10, I believe, yes.
All right. I have a question.
Oh, yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Joanna's next.
Okay. For this cause, ought the woman to have power on her head? And these angels, if they're bad angels, is the power on her head, not necessarily her hair, but the fact that some women are kind of bossy and...
It could be.
And we shouldn't be that way?
Well, that's a possibility. But you see, the power on the head, this is all about hair length and head.
Okay.
It seems like the power of the head, it seems to be together, but it could be the other. Should women be bossy?
No.
Should men be bossy?
Should men
be bossy, but try to work together. Yes, don't you? Yes, sir.
But as you're speaking, it's referring to those that are fallen, and in 2 Peter 4, it says, "For if God spared not the angels of sin, but cast them down to hell and delivered them the chains of darkness to be reserved unto the judgment."
Right.
So even the fallen, the giant, whether giants are actors or not, or if hair is the issue or not, it's still,
they're fallen. That's good. So that must be why I brought that whole thing up, because in 2 Peter, that's where the angels are fell.
So it's 2 Peter 2:4, where John is bringing in this thought about the... judgment, perhaps not the judgment of the great white throne judgment, but the judgment of the tribulation. Is that where you're coming from, John? Or aren't you sure?
Oh, well, I've heard some rumors that there might be a return of Nephilim during the tribulation period.
Right, but as far as the that verse used to support that, the 2 Peter
4.
2:4.
2 Peter 1.
2, chapter 2, verse 4.
It could be Daniel.
It could be
Randy.
Just wondering. I mean, if there is another type of evil other than the curse of sin, that would really confuse things. I mean, if somebody would then be absolved from sin nature if they couldn't help it. In other words, they're part Neptune or something. You know what I'm saying? That would be like, what do they call it?
An excuse or something.
An excuse. Something. So would there be any more possibility? I mean,
well, we just don't know. The tribulation period, the 7-year tribulation, is all kinds of evil that could happen. Just amazing. A big thick book that we got out, about 1,100 pages on Revelation, there's so many things that are in there that just... mind-boggling, actually, so we don't know what's really going to happen. So any other comments on verse 10 before we look? Yes, or verse 11, verse 10. Yes, John.
How much does that book cost?
I don't remember.
It's supposed,
$40. It's supposed to be up to 50, but I cut it down to 40.
Okay.
That could have been a book conference. So.
No, I think it's just 50, down to 40.
Which one are you talking about?
Revelation. In fact, if everybody in here wants it, we'll put it down to 30. We'll give you a special. We'll go see who is it. Yes, hello, Jacob from Texas. Go ahead, Jacob.
Yes, sir. Let me turn the light on down here.
Turn the light on. Okay, you need some light. Okay, give us some light.
The monitor don't bleed over, but the speaker, and then back to the... Say, on Revelation 9, verses 12-15, and this also applies to chapter 16, but... One woe is past, and behold, there come two woes more hereafter. And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel, which had the trumpet, loose the four angels, which are bound in the great river Euphrates. And the four angels were loosed, and they were prepared for an hour, and a day, and a month, and a year, for to slay the third part of men.
Yes.
And then finishes up with that.
Yes, that's certainly interesting. There's a lot of angels are going to be in trouble, aren't they? Thank you very much. Let's wave to Jacob in Texas. Thank you, Jacob. Well, Anna.
In an earlier part of Revelation 9, it talks about the locust being released from the bottomless pit.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I mean, if the locusts are the fallen angels or if they're just another creature.
Mm-hmm. All right, this. Yeah, Tammy, go ahead, Tammy.
Since we're diverting, I'm looking at Daniel 2:43.
Mm-hmm.
It's the image that Daniel saw, or actually Nebuchadnezzar saw, that Daniel explained. Whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay.
Sounds like
it almost sounds like a Genesis 6.
Then we have Matthew 24, you have as in the days of Noah. Perhaps it could go beyond that, I don't know, I mean, I was taking it a little bit with the slumming, they were rejecting the truth
mm-hmm.
as in the days of Noah, okay. but perhaps it goes beyond that.
That could be. Hannah.
And additionally, he that now letteth will be taken out of the way.
Mm-hmm.
So, if there's straining power, I mean, perhaps not just against mankind, but also against the power of Satan.
Mm-hmm. Like, the letteth being restrained. The Holy Spirit will be gone.
Satan.
Raptured. And so the restraining power of the Holy Spirit during tribulation is going to be over with. Yes, fine.
In Revelation 9:11, and they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue, Apollyon. Is that Satan?
Whoever it is, I don't know. He's the key. One of the key, I'm not sure whether it be Satan. But
king over the angel in the bottomless pit.
Well, it's an angel, so I don't know. It could be Satan, but
I don't think he's probably not there yet. He's not there yet.
He's going to be cast in the lake of fire after the millennium, okay. After the thousand years.
Judgment.
Yeah, Pastor Dan.
See, in verse 10, the angels, they had the wrong order. And when they rebelled against God,
mm-hmm.
they followed Lucifer, they fell. They put things, they weren't following God, they were following somebody else. They were following Lucifer and consequently
mm-hmm.
created problems. And so there's a certain order of things that have to be done. Otherwise, you know, I mentioned because of the angels, but because could be taken perhaps in a different sense. Mm-hmm. The angels are the example of look what happened to the angels when they wanted to do things their own way.
Mm-hmm.
They followed Lucifer and they fell from heaven.
Right. The second chapter of Second Peter, they got three different judgments. He didn't spare the angels that sinned. He didn't spare the old world that sinned. And Sodom and Gomorrah that sinned. There's three different judgments, and that's just one of them. All right, in verse number 11, nevertheless, why is it that so? In spite of it, anyhow.
Mm-hmm.
Neither is the man without the woman. What does that mean?
The man without the woman?
Yes.
It means he's happy. Does that mean he's happy?
That's one interpretation. What might be another interpretation? That's possible.
I'm just kidding.
No, it's all right. You take kids around here, too.
Right.
Big ones and little ones. Yes.
He can't be born without the woman.
That's right.
How he couldn't be made without the man.
That's true. So in verse 11, it says, neither is the man without the woman. That's by birth. And everybody's got to be born with the mother, see?
Yeah.
Neither is the woman without the man. Well, what does that mean?
She can't have a baby without the man.
Can't have a baby without the man. Also, what's that, Anna?
I said you need both to make a baby.
That's right, to make a baby. That's right. And, of course, too, the creation, Adam was first created, and out of his rib he made Eve. And so that was true, too. So I think verse 12, Mr. Woman is of the man. What does that mean? Oh, yeah, Anna.
Well, some would joke that without women, and men would still be in the Garden of Eden, but the trouble would be there would be only one of them, and he would be very, very lonely.
You're right. So, that's right, because Eve is the one that first.
We don't know. He still may have sinned irregardless.
That's exactly right. Yeah, John.
When it says one's of man, that talks about when God took the rib out of Adam and formed Eve,
mm-hmm.
the woman, with Adam's rib.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, Pastor Dan.
In the book of Genesis, when you have, when Adam and Eve hide themselves, God asked Adam, where art thou, Adam? And then he asked another question, hast thou eaten of the tree?
Mm-hmm.
Hast thou?
Yes.
He didn't say have ye.
That's right.
Says thou.
Singular.
Addressing Adam, mm-hmm. meaning he left Eve out of the question.
Right.
He said, do you do it? Mm-hmm. No, but I told you not to eat them.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So he was addressing Adam directly, thou, nominative, just a singular, mm-hmm. thou.
That's right.
That's correct.
And so it's because of Adam's sin, not Eve's, that all mankind, mm-hmm. through Adam, all of us are become main sinners. That's right. So in verse number 11.
Just because of Adam, not Eve, we belong once Adam and Eve, aren't we?
Well, that's,
in the bloodline.
That's true. Who ate the forbidden fruit first?
Eve.
Who ate it second?
Adam.
Did Adam have to eat it?
No.
If he hadn't eaten it, what would be true of Eve's state and Adam's state? What's that?
I said nobody knows.
Nobody knows, but
because
possibly.
That's not the way it happened.
That's not the way it happened, but possibly. It could be Eve would be with these bodies we have, and Adam could have lived forever with nobody.
Yes.
Anne Marie.
In Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 to even 18, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an help meet for him.
That's good. That proves that he gave a command before he was even made, even created from Adam's rib. That's right. Let's see. Pastor Dan, do you have something? I forget. Okay. Eddie and John first. Mm. Eddie and then Albert. One, two, three. Go ahead, John.
Eve fell, but Adam didn't, God probably would have cast Eve out of the Garden of Eden, and he could have created another Eve for Adam.
Well, that's a little fanciful, but it's possible. Of course, it's possible.
Well, just say in observance that from the very beginning in marriage, with the scriptures that come out later that say to whom is given much, much is required.
That's right.
And Adam had that on his shoulders because he was directed directly.
Right.
Meaning indirectly.
Right.
And we have an accountability.
Right.
Somebody else might do it, but you still have the responsibility.
That's right.
He's
the head of the house, and so head of the home. Yes, Joanne.
Well,
then Romans 5, we'll get Romans 5 talk. Yes,
well, as a woman, I think that if God had said something to Eve about it, she might have listened. And I think women, or at least me as a woman, mm-hmm. have a hard time being told what to do by mm-hmm. a man. And yeah. maybe that's part of our nature, and God would have forgiven us.
But they hadn't sinned yet.
They hadn't sinned yet.
But.
Yeah, that's true. It was very difficult. But see, Adam probably told Eve, did you get the
corn?
Yeah, but it came out of his
Adam,
mouth.
Adam, not God's mouth. What's Anna? I didn't hear that.
Apparently, he didn't tell her very well because she got the message mixed up.
What was her misquote? She had a misquote. What did she misquote?
Neither shall you touch it.
Neither shall you touch it. That's right. Yeah, fine.
She said, Adam, would you please leave me alone and stop telling me what to do? Not over there by yourself in the garden. And then that very moment, the very time when he wasn't observing, she sinned.
That's
she
right.
didn't sin. She did whatever she did.
Okay, Eddie.
But listen, look.
I'm listening.
Did Adam know? Adam knew it was a sin, but Eve didn't, correct?
Unless he told her.
Well, it doesn't say that.
No, I know.
But Adam knew it was a sin. That means even though if Eve did eat it first, she didn't know it was a sin, right?
Possibly.
All right. So Adam knew it was a sin. That's why they say Adam sinned first, right?
Well, not Eve first, but Adam took after her.
But how could Eve sin first when it doesn't say she didn't know?
Okay, Pastor Dan. Tammy. Yeah.
I just want to read that verse you were talking about, Romans 5:12.
Yes.
Therefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
See, by one man sin entered. Not Eve, the man. God put the man in charge, He left the whole thing. Pastor Dan.
1 Timothy 2:13, for Adam was first formed in Eve. Adam was not deceived. The woman being deceived was in the transgression. So Adam was not deceived. He did it.
He did it. Well, no, well,
right.
And I think in
order, but he knew it was a sin.
Oh yes, he right. did it willfully.
The woman was deceived.
The woman was deceived.
Because
the woman
was, who deceived the woman? Clearly.
The Satan.
Serpent. Satan, the serpent. That's right. Right. Albert. But, oh, shoot me, then so, Caroline. After that,
totally speculation. When Adam looked over, saw that Eve had taken and ate of it, and saw that she wasn't dead, his mindset might have been.
In my Bible, the reference for chapter 11 says, in Galatians 3:28 says, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female. Now, for ye all are one in Christ Jesus.
Uh-huh. That's right. In the spiritual sense, not male, female, but in the spiritual sense, you're just all the same. Yes,
but the serpent talked to Eve, correct?
Okay. Yes.
Right. So she knew. So that means she had to know not to do that. And the serpent talked him into doing it. So that means she had to know.
All right. What did the serpent say to Eve that made her...
All right.
Do it.
Well, look at that. He
first, you'll be as God.
Right.
And what else?
As God said.
As God said, but also
he shall know.
So no, it's not knowledge, which I'm not right. It's not about knowledge. So Satan promised her something.
Right.
And she
lied.
She lied, as he always does.
Right.
And she was deceived. Anna.
He mixed the truth with error.
Mixed the truth there.
That's what he does.
He said, I mean, part of what he said was true, but it was very misleading.
Yes. When you mix truth with error, what is it? Truth or error?
Error.
It's error. Even if it's a little truth, it's still error. He wants us complete. All right, so did God tell Adam... they were not to touch
right.
the tree. Did he tell Adam
yes.
not to touch it?
No.
Yes or no? We're divided. Who's right?
Well, the scripture is.
Okay.
The scripture says, thou shalt not eat of it.
That's right. That's what he told
right.
Adam.
That's what I said. That's what he told Adam.
No.
But he didn't say anything about not to touch touching it.
Did he tell Adam not to touch the fruit?
Oh, come
no.
on.
He didn't say he couldn't want it. He didn't say he couldn't touch it.
He didn't need it.
Look at it.
That's right.
That's
the
why Adam sinned first, right?
Not Eve. That's right.
But Adam did sin first.
No. Eve sinned first.
Eve sinned
okay.
first.
But Adam was responsible for the thing because he was the head of the.
Oh, all right, whatever. Yeah. Okay.
All right.
Satan came to Eve to deceived her
right.
first.
Right.
She gave to Adam, and he deliberately, willingly
took it.
Disobeyed.
That's what I mean.
Because he listened to his wife.
Right. And the thing is,
that's what he said.
And I believe the reason, he did that was so that both of them would be in the same judgment together. I don't think he wanted to part, even though he was wrong in eating it, and she was wrong in eating it, didn't want to be part, he wanted to be together. So they both fell, but they were equal. If one had eaten the other hadn't, some would be living forever, the other would be...
Hey, like that.
So it's a situation, yeah, John.
So when Adam took the fruit and sinned, he actually was putting Eve first, God second, and showing that he actually loved Eve more than he did God.
Possible, if that's the situation. Possible, yes.
And the effects of marriage being one flesh, whatever you do affects the other.
That's exactly right. Mm.
It does.
So,
Or he didn't want Eve to be smarter than him.
Didn't want Eve to be smarter, that's true. She wanted this knowledge, I guess, and they did know that. Remember, they didn't know what sin was until they broke the law of God. Then they knew what.
Then they knew they were naked and all.
So they knew they were naked and they had to clothe themselves. Yeah, fine.
The Shekinah left them.
The Shekinah Gora left them and touched them. They covered them up before that. All right, so that's verse 11. Neither the woman without the man in the Lord. All right. So we have the two of them working together. 10, 11, and 12. We read 12. I think we asked about 12. The woman is of the man, meaning what again? I think we already answered that.
From
this Adam's side. And so the man also is by the woman. What's that mean?
Born.
The women bear the children, whether it's a boy or a girl. It's the women that bear. And it says, in the all things are of God. All things were from God. He's the one that designed everything. All right, let's read verse 13, 14, and 15. In fact, we'll go to 16. No, just 15. 13, 14, and 15. Judge in yourselves, is it comely that a woman pray unto God uncovered? Does not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him? But if a woman have long hair, it is the glory to her, for her hair is given her for a covering. My verse 13, judge in yourself, is it comely? What does comely mean?
Appropriate.
Appropriate, what is it?
Becoming.
Becoming.
Fitting.
Fitting, all right. That a man have long hair. Shoot, let me get this number, go ahead. Hello?
Hello, Dr. Waite.
Yes.
Jonathan.
Jonathan. Go ahead, Jonathan.
Let me go.
The other room. I wanted to say hello to everybody first.
Uh-huh.
And I see Joanne and Eddie and Andy there. Like he's got a new young girl with him now. I won't tell Anna Marie.
Okay.
Anyway, Genesis 5:2, male and female created he them, and blessed them, and called their name Adam, in the day when he created them.
Mm-hmm.
So God called them Adam. And it was Adam that called Eve, her name Eve. So he called them Adam, and he told Adam not to eat of the fruit.
Right.
So it would be on both of them.
Okay, well, thanks a lot, Jonathan. Appreciate that. Let's wait for David Jonathan and filled up.
Yeah, that was good.
Jonathan, thank you, Jonathan. Appreciate
that. That was
good. Anna.
Well, I'm not sure. I mean, I understand why he might make that conclusion, but if we look at the tense, the pronoun in Genesis 2:16 and 17,
mm-hmm.
and the Lord commanded, it actually says the Lord commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat,
mm-hmm.
but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die.
So it's singular.
That's right. So it's singular.
So singular. And also it says God commanded the man. It doesn't say God commanded Adam.
That's right.
So
that's why I said.
All right, Tammy.
In verse 23, it says, and Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman. Mm-hmm. Adam named her.
Yes, Adam.
God did not name her.
Right. And
I'm not sure where it says about Adam.
Call their name Adam. And Adam comes from the Hebrew word Adma, which means dust, because he came out of the dust. So he's called the dust man. The dust man. He's not a dust pan. Yeah. Dust man.
Adam and Adama, right?
Adam Adma. Okay. That's right. Adam and Adama. That's right.
And so, I mean, someplace I'm looking for the verse he was reading.
Yeah.
He Adam. Says he called their name Adam, or called Adam. Is it called his name or their name?
Their name, I think he said.
And so
probably chapter 2 or maybe.
I'm not sure if it's okay, so that's maybe it's reflected the Adama and Adam together. I don't know.
I could be. All right, Anna. And then Barbara.
Chapter 5,
verse
2.
5,
verse
2?
Yes.
Genesis 3:20. It says, and Adam called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. So that's that was after the fall when he called her Eve. But before that, she was called woman.
That's right. So for Eve, that means the living one, the living one in Hebrew. And by the way, that man and woman, it's interesting, the two Hebrews, a man is Ish, and woman is Isha. The feminine, the Ish and Isha. So that's just like man and
woman.
Woman. See, the man and man. See, woman, Ish, Isha. It's very similar. All right, any other comments on this verse? Oh, excuse me, found.
Now that we found it, Genesis 5, 1 and 2.
Yes.
This is the book of the generation of Adam. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of man, made he him. Male and female created he them, and blessed them, and called their name Adam in the day when they were created. That's sort of interesting.
Essentially, call their name.
That's thou.
Dust people. All right.
The command is still, it's thou. It's specifically Single. Given to Adam.
Yes. That's right, given to Adam.
So if the command was specific, very specifically given to Adam.
Oh, yes.
I mean, perhaps if it was just Eve that had taken of the forbidden fruit. And we don't know because that's not what happened.
Seems like it's snowing outside.
It is. Yeah. But who actually ate it first? That's the thing. Who ate it first?
Eve first. Then Adam.
The point is, the command was very. It was specific to Adam. I mean.
That's right.
I mean, it was. Yeah. I mean, we don't know what would have happened if Adam had not also eaten.
Yes.
But
yes.
It could be that Eve would not have been. Because Adam.
Anne-Marie and then Eddie.
Okay. Knowing that God specifically spoke to Adam, singular, thou, but when the serpent came to Eve, when he said, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods.
Knowing good and evil.
That's right.
See, so she wanted to be as God and wants to know good and evil. She wanted to have education, knowledge. Eddie.
See, most people say Eve ate it. Some people say Eve ate it first, but I think the way I see it, I think Adam did it first.
The scripture is very clear.
Okay. Yes. All right.
Go ahead to Barbara and then Ed. And Randy.
I'm still chewing on it.
Okay. Does it taste good?
Very mild sweetness,
Randy, go ahead.
Okay. A lot rested on Adam. Why would... It's as if God... Or why would the devil, who knows, but go this route to trip Adam up? It must have been the most effective route.
It's very effective. You're right.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Versus coming directly to him. Why did he go this way?
That's right. If the serpent had gone to Adam first, what would Adam have done, do you think?
He would have probably... not done it.
Maybe not done it. See, that's interesting. But Eve, she's sort of a secondary person because maybe Adam told her, but maybe didn't tell her right. Yes, Randy and then Barbara.
Not to stick up for any wrongdoing on anyone's part. I've thought of this scenario, how Adam was created outside the garden. Okay, yes. Eve was not. She only knew to be in the garden. Adam knew the consequences of life outside the garden.
Yes.
Eve did not. And that could have been a factor where some person, one would be aware of what the loss would be and one would not.
Yes, it's possible.
Just possible.
It's possible, yeah. Barbara.
This Satan comes to Eve and he says to her, you know, yea hath God said, ye shall not eat food. Where I come from, that's y'all.
Yeah, y'all.
So y'all shan't eat of that. And the woman answered, we.
Yes.
So back to somebody's comment about the oneness of the flesh in marriage. And this would have been... Our problem is we can't understand where they're coming from. We have never been in perfection.
Right.
So God made them a couple.
Right.
A one unit. So that, and in his order of God, Christ, man, woman, the responsibility still lands on Adam.
Right.
Yeah.
But the responsibility is we. So when she sinned, it was we. There was still a we. And so when she offered it to Adam, he partook for whatever reason.
Whatever reason.
Which brings us to Romans. Because he was God, Christ, man, woman.
Yeah. By one man, sin entered the world. That's Adam. That's right. Okay, thank you.
Why did Adam let Eve wander around the garden by herself? He should have been with her.
I don't know.
Why?
Apparently,
Why did
there were dangers back in the garden?
No dangers.
Yeah, but still, why wouldn't they have been together?
I don't know. Maybe it was doing a little bit of gardening.
At some point, Satan fell, which it's possible that, you know, Satan fell and then he immediately decided to go as soon, like, just about as soon as he fell and do this, because, and so then they wouldn't have known about the dangers.
Mm-hmm.
Because everything was good. The Lord said everything was very good. And then Satan became lifted up with pride in himself, and then he decided to mess things up more.
That's right, make man fall. Yes, Albert.
It was also the very first time that our opportunity for the gift of free will was...
That's right.
Tested, yeah.
That's right.
We failed
the test. That's right. But God created them with free will. That's what it is.
But God made her as a helpmate.
Yes.
So if he was working in the garden, she would have been with him. As a companion, so she would have been with him. Mm-hmm. So therefore, why was she wandering around the garden by herself?
Well, she was out of line, wasn't she? Yeah, Rick.
My own interpretation, and that just be, when I read verse 6, Of chapter 3, it says, when a woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave also unto her husband with her. Now, I know it's, I think Barbara said someplace else there's in Timothy where there's a conflict, mm-hmm. but this, the way I read it, her husband was with her when she was being tempted and when she took it of fruit.
So there are three things.
I'm glad
you read that, Rick, because you mentioned three things. Pleasing the eyes, good for food, desire to make one wise. Three positives. I want that.
Right.
Yeah, I want that. Yes, who's next? I forget. Yvonne, did you say something?
No, I already made
that. Oh, okay. Made that. Thank you, Rick. That was good. All right, so we see that, that the man is not a woman, more than a man. All things are God's. Judge yourselves. Is it comely or is it fitting that a woman pray unto God uncovered? Now, that's the question that many people have. What is the covering? What do some people teach, such as the people over in Pennsylvania? What do they think the covering
is? They teach it as a special cover.
Special, like what?
It's what I wore was made out of netting.
Netting and so on, because you were
Mennonite.
So a covering of some kind, see, like a hat or a veil or a handkerchief, whatever, just a covering. That's what they interpret that as. Yeah, Dan, that's it.
And sometimes these coverings only cover part of the head, not all of the head.
That's true.
Yeah, I mean, it's not all covered, but sometimes we just cover the top of the head rather than the entire head, like a veil type of covering.
Right.
So I mean, if you have a covering that's made, it needs, if you're going to use the argument, you have to have a covering of like a veil or not necessarily a hat, but some type of head covering. It has to cover the entire head.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just cover the top of the head or part of the top of the head.
But in verse 15, yeah, what is...
Like the Muslim women.
Muslim women.
Exactly.
Yeah, verse 15, what does God say the covering is? How does he define covering?
Long hair.
The long hair. That's, the hair is given to her for a covering. So, women to pray. Now, it says in the book of 1 Timothy, and there may be this, in 1 Corinthians, this was done. Women prayed in the church, but it said... In 1 Timothy, it says very clearly, it's the male, our sense, it's the males that would pray in the church, you see. But this one, the women apparently are praying, but had to pray uncovered. Was it?
The women might have had their own meeting.
They could have their own meeting, that could be. But they may have prayed also publicly. But anyway, uncovered. Yes,
it's possible they could be praying outside of corporate worship.
It could be outside corporate worship, that's right. And then in verse number 14.
Just a moment. Oh, he's also praying that they may be. Someone may be leading in prayer, but they're still praying, although they're not leading the prayer.
Mm-hmm. That could be.
Women, there could be you know, when people today, women pray today silently in the pews, I would suspect.
That's true.
You know, when prayers were being made in this room. Mm-hmm. And so in that sense, they were praying silently, not necessarily verbally out loud.
All right. Could be a special women's prayer meeting also. So, but in verse 4, excuse me, whatever.
I'm not getting the context of the church in here, you know, being in a church setting, in a home setting or whatever.
Well,
that this is just the general order of things.
It could be. But it seems like it's a whole setting in 1 Corinthians, like to be in the local church, but it could be something that could be separate from the local church. That's true.
Just in general.
Be in general.
Because, you know, I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ and the head of every woman is the man and the head of the Christ is God. That's a general statement. That has nothing. That doesn't stop when I leave church.
Well, that's true. That's true. But all these things, it could be in churches, the first 4 and 5, everyone in the press with a hiccup. It could be in private meetings, women's meetings, could be at home, could be anything. Yes, Pastor Dan.
I mean, sometimes when people interpret it strictly for the corporate worship, the women only wear partial head covering, external head covering. I mean, people that are saying head covering is a hat, which is a partial head covering, not really a, but nonetheless, they only have it for corporate worship. Now, in the context of some people, the people in Pennsylvania, the wood ladies in Pennsylvania, not only during the corporate worship, but even outside the corporate worship, do they wear their head coverings.
All of them, yeah. Try it. Have fun.
Well, I always wondered if you wear this head covering 24/7, except when you take a shower. Mm-hmm. Then you can't pray when you take a shower because you take
it unless you have long hair.
Yes.
Then you got your covering, even in the shower.
Shower
even the shower cat, you still got
your covering. If you hire your crane, quickly put on your shower cat.
Wash your hair.
But you wash your hair.
You still got the hair.
If you decide to pray, you have to quickly grab your shower cap and put it on.
Anyhow.
Are we getting down to the law here and not the spirit?
Could be. Yes, Anna.
But if the hair, if the covering is the hair,
yes,
then the hair goes with you wherever you are.
That's right. All right, Anna.
This is a wig. Well, okay, so...
then you're all totally
in later in the book of 1 Corinthians, it says in chapter 14, verses 34 and 35, let your women keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak. But they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. And if they will learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for women to speak in the church. So, well then, how does that relate to them praying or prophesying and the theory that that's in the church versus just generally?
That's possible. Could be general.
Well,
could be general.
But
must be private, because you say chapter 14 is very clear. You're not to be praying and speaking in the church. It's a law against women preachers, really, that verse says.
Is it against any type of speaking in the church, or is it against...
Well, I think the speaking sense of leading and preaching the pulpit and leading. They got a lot of women preachers. They're getting more and more every time. Joanna and Barbara.
I have a question, because I thought in some Jewish sects that the women wear wigs to cover their head.
They do.
They do? Yeah. Okay.
And also the men, when they're in synagogue, they wear their little hats.
Uh-huh, right.
So, and this is saying that they shouldn't be wearing any covering.
Well, if the covering is a hat, but if the covering is a hair, if they got short hair, they're uncovered. If it's short hair, they're uncovered.
But the men, I'm talking
that's
about the men.
That's what they mean, the men. That's what I mean, the men. See, in other words, if indeed we see in verse 14, even they should teach you, if a man have long hair, it's a shame on him. Her hair is given to her as a covering in verse number, what is it, 13? 12? Where is it? The covering. It's right here. Did we lose it?
15.
What is it?
15.
But if a woman has long hair,
oh, yeah, so that's for 15,
for his hair is given to her.
So, Joanne, if we define the covering as the hair, either men or women, then that's fine. But if you cover the covering like a hat or that, well, that's a different situation. So the man, you know, the Jews, they have the hat over,
their yarmulke.
As far as I'm concerned, the men should have the heads uncovered and inside. I mean, that's the military. That's the way I would think. But they have a little different situation. And Anna.
Well, it's, I mean, the majority of the Jewish men who wear yarmulkes would not consider this particular passage to be part of Scripture.
That's right.
Because they
Old Testament.
Do not recognize Christ as the Messiah.
That's right.
So therefore, I mean, this passage is specifically for believers.
For believers, Christians. That's right.
It doesn't necessarily apply to them per se.
Right.
Or if they should believe, then it would apply. But.
All right. Jill, got something?
Oh, no, Albert was
going to say something about the
Israelites.
No. Okay, Tom and then Barbara.
Why do Jewish women wear wigs all the time? I didn't know this.
Okay, Barbara?
In the same vein as the Islam women cover their heads, because you have to understand this is the Mideast, okay? And the Mideast women covered, the proper society women covered, and the Islamic women still cover for the same reason that it is for their husband, not for the world, so to speak. What they are as women is for their husband.
All right.
That's why they cover.
Yeah.
Good.
That's probably what this passage is all about.
Does the wig keep them warm?
Wigs are horribly hot.
Oh. I think of the Indians, the American Indians, the wigwam.
Yeah. That was worth it. In the study that I have done about what Anna was talking about, and women keeping quiet in the church, had to do with, again, back to the Middle East custom of women were separate from men in worship. And in the synagogues, which is Paul taught in synagogues a lot, the women were in their own balcony or in the back of the church. And if they couldn't hear, they'd yell down to their husband and say, what did he say?
Yeah.
And so instead of, in a preaching situation, reading of the scripture situation, it was very distracting. Right. So, therefore, they were to ask their husbands at home what the minister said when he got home, not to disrupt the service.
Good, yes. Randall
said
it. Right. Just a question. Is there a closer definition of the word silent and the word speaking? Is it a type of silence, a type of speaking that's not good, versus any speaking at all? Is there differences in speaking?
I don't know. It seems like silence and speaking is speaking, but there may be a distinction. Randy, I'm not really sure about that.
Okay.
That's a good point. Yes, Eddie.
In three books of the Bible, it specifically says a woman is to keep silent in the congregation. I never read anything about. Some pastors say it's because they were gossiping. Some pastors said because of what she said. Mm-hmm. I never read nothing like that in the Bible.
Mm-hmm. So, that's right. See, it
specifically says a woman is supposed to keep silent in the congregation.
Right.
And silent means silent.
Not to be leading in the congregation.
Right, and it didn't say anything about anything else.
Church services, and we consider Bible studies as different from the actual preaching of the church. Yes, Randy.
I'm just thinking about the whole general topic here, Pastor Wade. Is this subject of coverage, is it like hard and fast, definite, covered, uncovered in a certain way or not? Or is it more subjective as just to the principle of who man is and who woman is, that one not be covered and one be covered because of the creation, like Paul relates later to that in regard to...
But when we get down to verse 14-15, we'll see that picture, I think. That's Barbie, that's it? Okay. All right. We were in 13. Where we were 13, prayer got uncovered. And verse 14, nature itself teach you. What does it teach you in verse 14? What does nature teach you in verse 14?
That long hair is a shame for men.
It's a shame for man to have long hair. Do we have long hair men today?
Yes.
Yes, we do.
Samson had long hair, didn't
yes.
he?
What was his Nazarite. Long hair for?
Strength.
He was a Nazarite.
And what is a Nazarite? What were the Nazarites to do?
Not drink.
Not to drink.
Not cut their hair.
Not cut their hair. Nothing of the fruit of the vine. Not even grapes. The mother shouldn't even drink grapes. And the hair should be length and long, long, long. When they stopped the Nazarite vow, what did they do to their hair?
They cut it.
They cut it. And then
Paul,
they
Paul did his Nazaritic vow, and he went. Paul had it was had a Nazaritic vow that he had to go and pay. Mm-hmm. And finish, and he would have gotten his hair cut.
Yes. So that was one thing. What about the hippie generation? What was their hair like, boys and men?
Long.
Very long, very long.
What's the question?
What was the hippie generation? Do men, some men even today, have long hair?
Yes, some. Not as much.
Not
I don't
much
think not as much as they used to.
No, not as much.
I mean, I had long hair,
yeah,
you
but
know.
They still have a lot of people that are longer hair. And what does God say about long hair on men?
No.
It's a shame.
It's a shame.
But how long is long?
Yes.
Well,
how long is long?
It'd certainly be probably shoulder length. I mean, shoulder length would be the longest.
You're supposed to see the ears.
Maybe
no,
so.
Where in the Bible
does it say you have to see their ears? Well, we don't know exactly. Yes, Joe. Joe, go ahead. Go ahead, Joe.
Be able to tell if you're a boy or a girl.
Yes,
man or a woman.
You're
so,
able
you
to
know,
tell.
There might be people who push the envelope and talk about this is way better about just people in general out there in the world.
Yeah.
What's long? What? How do you define long? They might use yeah. as justification to make it longer and longer or mm-hmm. however long they want.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, Anna.
Sometimes, too, it depends on, like, the determining whether, I mean, is, like, the type of haircut. Like, sometimes some mm-hmm. haircuts are more feminine, even though they might be trolling.
Mm-hmm.
And some cuts are more masculine.
The Bible doesn't say what's long or short. Yes, go ahead, Albert.
Well, another one of the confusions is, especially for those who don't study and aren't learned, is that so many of the churches have images of Christ on the wall.
With long hair.
And
yeah.
long hair.
Yeah.
And they justify, well, Christ had long hair,
yeah.
so I can have long hair.
Yes, but what was the Roman length of hair in Jesus' day? What was that Roman length?
Short.
It was short, see. So the whole pictures of Jesus' long hair, I believe, are absolutely false, and there's idolatry. Shouldn't we have worship and image anyway? But they should cut them all down. It's a bad thing. But Vaughn and then John.
Well, in those days, they didn't cut the hair like you know, like people have their hair and shaved, you know, with a razor and this. Even though it was short, it wasn't fixed like it is today.
No.
I think wasn't it World War I when they start cutting their hair like because of the bugs and stuff in the trenches?
I'm not sure of the date of it. Yeah, John.
When did the traditions start where all these painters start or pictures start painting Christ with long hair? How did that start?
I don't know the date of that. Anybody know?
Well, it was in the Middle Ages.
Middle Ages? What's his name?
Rembrandt. He's got the
Leonardo.
Before Rembrandt.
That's what I said. Middle Ages.
Middle Ages would be what? 1100, 1200?
No, it was during the Renaissance period.
Renaissance would be 1400.
Renaissance. So later.
The Dark Ages.
It was definitely the Renaissance when Michelangelo, etc.
Did that thing. What was that thing? The chapel? What chapel was that?
Sister's Chapel.
What were the dates of Michelangelo?
I don't know.
I forget.
Didn't he come to like 1500s, early
16? Something like that.
All right. So we don't know the answers. We don't know, but it started sometime.
Well,
all right. Yes.
They're not supposed to be no pictures or statues, nothing like that anyway. You know,
That's true. We shouldn't have any pictures, of images of.
We don't
Christ.
Know what he looked
That's
like.
That's idolatry, in a sense, even though it's not a big goal. Pastor Dan and Randy. Tammy, go ahead. Okay. For Randy.
You are.
Yes, you are. Now, do you have
something? As far as art, you know, the art of the Dark Ages back to, you know, early on, you know, as soon as they had the right comments,
mm-hmm.
as soon as they used to run, when people were illiterate and they thought, well, we have to have these icons so people could see
mm-hmm.
what the Bible's saying. In all the icons, you have these people with these men with long hair.
Uh-huh.
Orthodox churches back in the early centuries, 3rd and 4th centuries, had Christ with shoulder length hair.
Yes. You brought up a word, the icons. What is an iconoclast?
Someone that gets rid of the icons.
Someone get rid of the icons, that's right. He smashes the icons. That's
what's
right.
It called?
Iconoclast. Iconoclast.
Class?
C-L-A-S-T. Class.
Oh, class. Class. I thought you said class.
No, class.
C-L-A-S-S. Class. C-L-A-S-T.
A-S-T, right. So, just an interesting top question for you people that are very smart and wise. So, it's uncommon for a woman to pray uncovered. Her hair is given to her. And there's a covering, verse 15. If a woman has long hair, what's true of that in verse 15?
It's a glory to her.
Then what does it say? Her hair is given to her. Why? Why was her hair given to her by the Lord? For a covering. So there's a battle, there's a fight. What in verse 13? Covered. In verse 15, covered. A different Greek word, but the covering is a covering. And it's, I think we ought to be clear that God has given us a definition of what it is in verse 15. It's the hair.
Which two words were different?
Yeah, go ahead. Pardon me?
Which two words were different?
The covering in the earlier part, uncovered and covering. Could be verse 13, maybe verse 4. Let me see, verse 4. Covered, yeah, that's right. They're different Greek words, but the idea is it's something that goes over and takes care of it. And I think this verse 15 makes it very clear as to what God means as far as the covering. See, so regardless of the different Greek words, there's a big battle. That's why the Mennonites and others, some of the Roman Catholics had covered in hats and different things. And some, nothing, I have nothing against women that want to wear hats in the church. I have no problem at all with them. But the scriptures, it's especially the hair that's given for covering. Well, let's read verse 16. 17 and 18 together. If you don't mind, this last subject's a little bit hairy. Let's go 16, 17, 18. But if any man seems to be contentious, we have no such custom, neither the churches of God. Now in this that I declare to you, I praise you not, that you come together, not for the better, but for the worse. For first of all, when you come together in the church, I hear that there be divisions among you, and a quarrel is to lead it. All right, in verse number 16. What does contentious mean?
Quarrelsome.
Quarrelsome. Argumentative. Contentious. There are no such custom in the church of God. Now, one of the long-haired men used to come to our church. He quoted this verse, said, see, no such custom. I said, you do what you want. But the scripture seemed to me, how does verse number 13 or verse number 14, if a man have long hair, it's a shame. How does that fit in to get? So he argued with me. He's over at Wendy's. He used to come every single day, every single Sunday. He was there with hair down to the back of his shoulders. And in fact, I told him this is very clear, but he didn't think it was clear. All right, Anna, go ahead.
We have no such custom. Isn't that referring to the contentious? We don't have a custom of contentious.
Custom of contentious. That's what I would interpret it. Not custom for the long hair short. That's the way to get out of it, huh? Very good. It's an escape clause. Okay. No such custom. Neither the churches of God. In other words, yes, fine. Men's calling.
This is the question then. How long is long and how short? Because women probably in these days had real, real long hair. And I mean, and a man with his hair to his shoulders, that would be short. I'm not
Comparison. But my contention is your hair certainly is longer than mine.
Yeah, but
therefore, you got long hair, I got shorter.
It's really long hair. I've had long hair.
It's not as long as it could be, but it's certainly longer than mine. Some people are bald.
Then I've got my hair.
Randy.
Well, Pastor, I thought about this issue and the issue not to distract, but about dress.
Yeah.
The issue of appearance in general. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of notions in our world that the visual appearance doesn't matter. People believe, according to the Bible, the visual mm-hmm. appearance doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. But this would, rather than laying down legalistic lengths of hair, mm-hmm. could be like that visual appearances do matter.
Yes.
As far as dress, as far as hair
right.
length,
yeah.
or how we appear rather than, because some people don't have the same kind of hair. I mean, you know, some people have lost some.
Yes.
But it's just interesting. Women don't tend to lose their hair like a guy mm-hmm. does.
And some people just scrape their hair off, even though they haven't lost it, just the bald.
Yeah.
So that's interesting. It's appearances, isn't it? You wonder when somebody's going down the street,
right.
Is it a he or she? We don't know, but anyway.
And that happens.
Rather than not, I'm just saying it would be wrong to say that the appearance of the hair length does not matter. That would be wrong.
Right.
It does matter, whether no matter what perspective or scale we judge it by.
Right. All right. So we have no contention. Carolyn, I'm sorry.
Yeah, on that word contentious, I have the definition here that says loving to quarrel and angrily debate.
Yes, that's a good definition. Angry, loving to quarrel, angry debate. That's very good. We have no such contention with the custom Mr. Kefan.
I know. It was a Tamar, the one
yes.
in the Bible.
Tamar, the harlot?
She plays the harlot.
She played the harlot, okay.
And in that passage, the harlots had their head shaved.
Yes.
I believe that was the same passage.
Mm-hmm.
And that was evidently a sign that they were harlots. Mm-hmm. So usually we don't...
Well, it says in this chapter here, all that we were shorn or shaven.
Yeah.
Because that's what harlots did in the early days when Paul was writing this. They had
a passage in Genesis, I don't think.
No, but I'm talking about 1 Corinthians 11.
She put away her widow garments. Widow. Yeah. Put on other garments.
But yeah. She didn't shave her head.
No, I don't think so.
But it talked in that, I think in that passage, about the harlots having shaven heads.
You sure it wasn't in chapter 11? Probably in 1 Corinthians 11.
In 1 Corinthians 11,
I read it.
It's not Genesis.
Yeah. All right. So, verse number 17. I think we're in 17. What is he praising them not for? What did they come together for worship? What was one of their motives here? Verse 17. What were some of the motives that they came together to worship?
It says for the better.
We're going to stop right here. Not for the better.
For the better, not for the worse.
I praise you coming again, not for the better, but for the worse. In other words, they're coming into the church services. The wrong motives, the wrong purposes, the wrong everything. And he doesn't praise them for that. And so he's going to take up the divisions that they have. I'm going to stop right here at this verse, but do you have any? We'll pick this up, Lord willing, next Lord's Day. But do you have any other comments or questions before we close? Yvonne.
This is not concerning the lesson, but pray for Cass. Some people don't know about
yes, that. Mrs. Weber. She was in the hospital at least maybe 2 days. She came back yesterday. She's home recovering. Had some transfusions. I think she said 7 different transfusions. That's what her daughter said. So she was really losing a lot of blood. So pray for her.
Wow.
Mrs. Weber. She's a very faithful one of our people, one of our members of our church. Yes,
is she still in the hospital?
No, she's gone.
She got out. I talked to her last night.
Yeah, she was in Jefferson. You talked to her last night.
Yes.
That's good. Any other comments or questions for
you? You saw her Friday.
Yeah, I worked at a job for Friday, and then
she's
supposed to meet me. I'm wondering what's happened, and then she called me last night, and she said she was in the hospital.
Oh, that's too bad. You know, Tammy.
These are the verses that talk about in Genesis.
Okay.
And she put up her widow's garments off from her and covered her with a veil and wrapped herself and sat in an open place, which is by the way to Timnath. For she saw that Shelah was grown and she was not given unto him to wife. When Judah saw her, he thought her to be a harlot because she had covered her face.
Covered her face, yeah. That's good. Well, thank you for the verse. Any other comments before we close?
What chapter is that?
38
Genesis
38 verses 14 and 15.
I
got one more thing. In 2001, I was going to this church at Cherry Hill. This is in 01. And there was I would go there every Sunday. And all of a sudden, the pastor had this woman preaching. And at the end of the service, I walked up to him and says, you know, in the Bible, it says a woman not supposed to preach. She's supposed to keep silent and preaches for the man. He told me God didn't write that part of the Bible. I never went to that church again.
God didn't write that part of the Bible.
See, people make all kinds of excuses for a woman to preach in the church.
I know.
Don't say anything.
Right. Any other comments or questions? All right, let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for thy word. We thank you that thou hast written it and thou hast given it to us. We have it in accurate translation from Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek in our King James Bible. We thank you for it. Thank you for these who have come. These who have taken part in our discussion about the different situations and the hair, different ones, men and women. These are very important verses that thou hast given. Very few people even understand, even know anything about these verses. We thank you thou hast given them to us. Help us to understand thy word. Help us to follow thy word to do what thou wast want us to have. Guide us and direct us. Bring us back safely on the Lord's Day, on Thursday Bible study as well. And guide us and direct us, and may our Savior be glorified in those of us who love thee and have been saved by the blood of Christ by genuine faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming.